Shishut Morei Rabotei, with the permission of Hashem. Oh. All the Sidra of the Parashiyot till the Zot HaBeracha, till Rosh Hashanah, Kippur, Sukkot, all those Parashiyot that will be studying every Shabbat, they are Parashiyot. It's a repetition that Moshe Rabbeinu repeated to the Bnei Israel before he died. Before Moshe Rabbeinu passed away, he repeated to the Jews all what they've been going through during the 40 years that they were in the desert. And then he repeated them all the mitzvot that Hashem, he told him to tell them. Understand? That's what we say, Mishneh Torah. It's a repetition of the Torah. What it is incredible. Sometimes, because I have one question. Why did Moshe Rabbeinu have to repeat again the Torah to the Bnei Israel? I don't understand why there is a book of Devarim. It's a repetition. Oh, what happened? I mean, for me, listen to this. You have a diamond, a real one. You have a real diamond. And you have another diamond that it look like the real one. Understand? But it's not the real one. So what is the best? The real one or the one that look like the real one? Of course, the real one, yes or no?
Yeah.
Of course. Of course, this is normal. So, all the mitzvot that Hashem, he told Moshe Rabbeinu to tell the Bnei Israel, those are the real one, because it was from Hashem to Moshe, from Moshe to the Bnei Israel. But what Moshe was repeating, he was repeating for himself, not from Hashem. You understand me? So all the Siddur of the Devarim, all those repetitions, are not the real. They are only repeated what Hashem once told him that he already told them. You understand? First question. Second question, why he need to repeat them? Why he needed to repeat them? They know already. I mean, look, if I tell you he's not going to smoke on Shabbat, I already teach you a few times. Can you imagine, during 40 years, the Jews, they repeated so much the Torah. You know, the Jews in the desert, they repeated so much the Torah. Pa, 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 pa. They repeat all the time, they repeat. Look, I was in the yeshiva. And every circle of 7 years, we repeat again what we've been studying, you know, during the last 7 years. Like Siyum Hashas. You do Siyum Hashas, then you start again. I know somebody that he already did the Siyum Hashas seven, eight times. But the best is the first one. Huh? The best happiness, it's when you do the first Siyum. Ah, after it, you know already. You know, when you repeat the Shas again, it's a repetition. So what I do not understand, the Jews, they know already all this. They know, like in the Parsha, it said, Moshe Rabbeinu spoke to them about the Avodah Zarah that he did, the Eikev that he did. He spoke to them about the wars that he did against Sihon, against Og. So all this, they know it. And they repeat to them all the mitzvot that Hashem he told him to teach them. They know it. What, so first, why Moshe Rabbeinu had to repeat? The Mishnah, the Torah again, and they said, they know it already. What's the purpose of that? So this morning I was thinking this. And there's a beautiful question that I saw from the book Da'at V'da'at. A fabulous question. The question is, Moshe Rabbeinu said, Eri HaDevarim, those are the words that I want to teach you. And the Midrash Tanhuma said that the Jews, they said to Hashem, to Moshe Rabbeinu, Moshe, I do not understand you. At the beginning, 40 years ago, when Hashem sent you to deliver the Jews, you told to Hashem, Lo ish tayv anochi. Hashem, why you want to send me to liberate the Jews? I'm not a man who would know to talk too much. So the Jews said to Moshe Rabbeinu, and 40 years ago you said to Hashem, you're not a man who talk too much, and now you talk too much. Eliyah Devarim, non-stop, you repeat everything. So the question is, how did the Jews can say that to Moshe Rabbeinu? Just imagine, you have in front of you a big tzaddik, a big rabbi, that never speak to you much. And suddenly start to talk to you, You would say, hey rabbi, I'm surprised at you. I know that you never talk too much, and now you talk too much. It's not. I mean, for 40 years he was teaching them Torah. For 40 years they never told him nothing. And suddenly now, they tell him this. I'm thinking, from here, understand. Maybe this is the truth. As much rich you can be, listen to this. As much money you can have, as much billions of dollars you can have, as much wealth you can have, you will only be like people that I know. The more money you have, the more less you're so sure about your wealth, you're so sure that with this you can live lives. Yeah. You don't care. You will not count them. You have so much, you will not count them. I remember, I'm not allowed to tell you which one. It was a king, one king. And this king, he was not well. And he was willing to give millions of dollars just to live another year. That means, and he used to spend money. You cannot imagine, he was burning money. You know, people that they are rich, they don't care about money. I remember, it's okay because they have so much. For them, it's nothing. Is that me?
Yeah.
Maybe this is the truth. For them, it's nothing. They waste it, they burn it. And I was in one wedding, somewhere, I'm not allowed to tell you where, they spent $2 million only for flowers. Only for 2 hours. For flowers, bonus or there was another one somewhere. He wanted to marry for the wedding of his daughter. You know what he did? He built up a synagogue with cartoon. There is a synagogue in the world that he loved it. So what he did? He built it. It cost him a few millions of dollars, only for a few hours. And then they threw it. Only for a few hours. And for him, it's nothing. It's nothing. These people who spend money, they burn it. They burn it. Can you imagine there is some people, they go to holidays, with suitcase of cash, they burn it, they don't care. That, it's only lifetime. They know that one day they will die, and so they want to enjoy themselves now. Now they have money, they don't care how much they spend. There is no value, nothing has no value. There was a woman, She wanted to make up, she wanted to suicide. She wanted to kill herself. Only because she told me, I have everything. I don't know what to do. I'm bored. I'm bored. I don't know what to do. I have a plane. I have houses. I have money. My husband. I have a shop of jewelry. I have a safe. A jewelry. I have everything. Fed up life. People think money is life. Money is death. The Gemara said, the more money, the more business you have, is the more problems that you have. You buy problems, but only for a person that all his mind is money, 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 but a person that he share his time, business normal, to do tzedakah, to live his Jewish life, and when there is a mitzvah, he do it, and he study Torah, and he pray like you guys, like you. So, never you can be bored. Never the money can make you crazy. I know people that they become crazy because of the money. You know why? When they have no Torah in life, when they have no mitzvot in life. But when there is mitzvot, money become good because they have a purpose to live. With this money, I can do mitzvot. I can do this. I can do that. So I understand. Bemet, this is emet. This is the truth. So now listen to what I want to tell you. That way, Moshe Rabbeinu Alav Hashalom, he repeated the Torah. What I learned, and the Jews, they know what Moshe Rabbeinu repeated. So why repeat them? The answer is, the more you repeat the Torah, you have chidushim. I mean, look, every time you study Torah, the same subject, you will understand it another way. There is never one way understanding the Torah. There is always millions of ways how you understand the Torah. That's what Moshe Rabbeinu wanted to teach the Bnei Israel. First, Moshe Rabbeinu told the Bnei Israel, hey, Jews, there is a difference when you count your money again, after you have fed up to count it, when you study the Torah, you repeat it, you repeat it, you repeat it. The more you repeat it, the more you understand it. The more you repeat it, it's another way of how the Hashem you can understand. I promise you, the more I study, I understand the Torah. And then another way, and the more I study, I have something else. I have another way. But the money remains the same money. You count $1 billion, it may remain $1 billion. But when you count, when you repeat the Gemara, there is another way that you will understand it. Understand? That's what Moshe Rabbeinu teach the Jews. He told them, I know what I'm going to teach you, you know it already. I know. But one thing I want you to tell you, the more you study Torah, the more you will understand it. It will be another way you will understand it. You know how many books I wrote? How many books how many times I spoke about one pasuk, and every time I speak about that pasuk, no. Now I want to teach something that I never had in my life. Now, according to that, now you understand. When the Moshe Rabbeinu started to talk to the Bnei Israel, they told, please listen to this. They told Moshe Rabbeinu, we know one thing about you. Since we know you 40 years ago, we know that you didn't want to be our liberator. You said to Hashem, Lo ish dvarim anochi. I'm not a man of talk. Now you don't stop talking. So we did ask one question. The question that we asked, how did the Bnei Israel can say that to Moshe Rabbeinu? I mean, they know Moshe Rabbeinu all the time he talk. So, during 40 years he talked to them. Why suddenly now they say to Moshe Rabbeinu, why say that you talk too much? I mean, it's not covered. Imagine you, if you tell me, Rabbi David, how did the man come only for a bracha? Now you give me a speech. I mean, it's not covered. Just to tell me this. You know why they say that to Moshe Rabbeinu? The Jews, they love Moshe Rabbeinu. They love him so much. Now they know that he's going to die. Now we talked to him. He knows he's going to die. And he was talking too much. He said, Moshe, if you talk too much, if you tell us everything after you're going to die, please don't talk. Talk slowly. Every time talk a little bit. So you will live. Understand? That was the Bnei Yisrael. That's the way I understand the Bnei Yisrael. The Bnei Yisrael, they loved so much Moshe Rabbeinu. Now they know that after the Milhama of Midian, they know after that the war against Midian, Moshe is going to die. Now if he die, they will miss him. They will miss his Torah. So they started to tell him, one day, we didn't want to talk. And now we talk so much. By talking so much, you're going to die. Because you will tell us everything you want to tell us, all the teaching, and then after you have to pass away. So please, don't talk too much. So every time you will talk a little bit, so you will live as long as you will live maybe another few months more. For us, it's very good. But Moshe Rabbeinu, knowing this is the time that has to go, so I have to tell them everything. Now, I want to tell you something incredible. Yes, I want you, focus what I want to tell you. It's something spectacular, what I want to tell you. Moshe Rabbeinu, he talked to them about Ve'lavan b'haserot v'dezahav. Moshe Rabbeinu, he reminded the Jews, he gives them some remontrance, some musar. He told them, remember what you did with the money that you got from Egypt. You did Avodah Zarah. Remember that the war that you did against me with Korah, a lot of things you did against Hashem. Don't forget that. Moshe Rabbeinu, he wanted to remember them, bad things that he did. But I want to explain to you that Moshe Rabbeinu, he mentioned to them, by giving them this kind of advice, he gives them a spectacular advice. You know, yesterday I received a man. And this man, he knows that he's a ganav. He steals from other people. He steals ideas. He steals money. He knows he don't eat kosher. He don't pray. He don't put tefillin. And he knows that with Hashem is not good. But he wants bracha. He wants blessing. And when a month I was looking at him, one hand he has emuna on the brachot. It reminds me that sometimes people, if only they can think, I mean, if you want to be a pilot, you cannot be a pilot. There is a lot of category of airplane. There is small airplane, there is big one, there is electronic airplanes. There is a lot of kind of airplanes. I mean, not because you are a pilot, you can pilot any plane you want. No. I mean, you cannot fly a rocket to the moon. Even if you are a pilot, there is rules. This man, he knows there is rules. You cannot be doing against Hashem all kind of things. On the other hand, you want from Hashem blessings. You want money, you want health, you want this, you want this. I mean, I was looking at him, I was shocking. I did not know what to do. So you know what I did? I prayed for him one tefillah. Hashem opened his eyes. Hashem opened his eyes that he can see. Help him, please. He's walking in the darkness. Open his eyes. In one hand, he loves you. In one hand, he believes in you. In one hand, but on the other hand, what he's doing. I mean, he lives a mixture of life. He lives a contradiction life. I mean, I'm sure, Fred, that for me, he wants to eat ham and not kosher food. I mean, he just received a good bracha from me with a caviar, with a blessing, and from there he will go to the restaurant eating something that is not kosher, and he knows that he is wrong. My friend, that's what Moshe Rabbeinu said to the Jews. Vede Zahav. What that means, Vede Zahav? Vede Zahav. That means Moshe Rabbeinu said, Hashem will give you a lot of money. And with that money, what you did? You did the Egel, you did Abu Dazara. And then Hashem will forgive you because you did the Teshuvah. And with that money, what you did? You sponsor the Mishkan. Understand? At least, and then you have to remain like this. I mean, at the beginning, you can do Avera. After you know that you did Avera, and you're alive, so you do the Teshuvah. So what do you do after? A mitzvot. At least this is what you have to stick in your mind. That's what Moshe said. Vede Zahav. What that means, Vede Zahav. De, please listen to De, that is you. Vede Veyad. What that means, Veyad is the hand. The hand that you did Avodah Zarah. What it is Zahav? Gold. What it is the gematria of Zahav? Tell me. 14.
Yeah.
What is it? Yad. Vede Zahav. On one hand you give to the Avodah Zarah, and on the other hand you give to the Mishkan. Yad. Understand? Vede Zahav. Vede Veyad. Yad. At least that was fantastic. Yes or no?
Yeah.
But how you get to that? Hatzot. Hatzot with Hashem, if you go to study Torah. Hatzot with Hashem. You know, we call the Beit HaMidrash Hatzot. Hatzot with Hashem. When you go to the Beit HaMidrash, you wake up. You understand that this is the way you have to act. That means without Torah, you will do all the time, one day Avodah Zarah, one day Mishkan, one day Avodah Zarah, one day Mishkan. But you have to stop. You did money, you used money for bad things, you did not know. So study Torah. By studying Torah, praying to Hashem, you will know that you did a mistake, so then what? You will change. Only Torah can change you. That was the advice that Moshe Rabbeinu gives to the Bnei Israel. It was a spectacular advice. Because there is a Yetzara, Lavan. Lavan is a Yetzara.
Yeah.
Why? Lavan is white. The Yetzara, he will show you. Life is white. It's not black. It's fantastic. Money, it's white. White. White, it's light. Don't worry. Girl. Get on! Everything is good. Moshe Rabbeinu, he warned him, watch out. The only way to escape from the Yetzara is Bahatzerot. Hatzerot is the yeshiva, limud Torah, like you do. And through the Torah, you make a difference from Videi Zahav. You make a difference when you do mitzvot, it's mitzvot. Not one day mitzvot, one day avelot, one day avelot, one day mitzvot. You mix your life. That was an advice that Moshe Rabbeinu gave to the Bnei Israel before he passed away. And if you follow the advice of Moshe Rabbeinu, so every time you study the Torah, you will not see the Torah the same way. You will see the Torah will change on your eyes. Yes?
I have a question.
Yes.
One day mitzvot, one day agavot, one day mitzvot, one day agavot. When you're in the regular course of daily life, you're faced with the temptations of business, of this. So what does a person do? So if a person makes a mitzvah and then he makes a mistake.
There is teshuvah.
Yeah, that's what can do it all the time.
Yes, but the more you study the Torah, the more you understand Torah. That means you did not understand enough Torah to support you to avoid the Averot. So the more you study the Torah, that's what the Pekavot said. Marbe Torah, marbe Chokma, marbe Torah. The marbe Yeshiva, marbe Chok. I mean, the more you sit in the Yeshiva, the more you study, the more you become. Look at me, I have a weight bear. Do you think I don't do Averot? Of course I do Averot. I'm not a tzaddik, I do Averot. But I, Baruch Hashem, I do Tshuva. That's because a lot of times, I don't see the Avera as Avera. You understand? And then after I realized that I did Avera, so I do Teshuva. Of course, I will not do Avera on purpose. I will not steal money from somebody. I will not eat a tarif on purpose. I will not, God forbid. But sometimes I can say, this is kosher. I can allow myself. Maybe, you understand? This is the advice that Moshe Rabbeinu, Alav Shalom. You understand? He told them, look what you did one day. You get a lot of money from Egypt. What you did? Me, Avod Azara. Then what you did? Mishkan. You paid with the God, the Mishkan. So he told the people Israel, this is not the way. Through the Torah, when you do a mitzvah, you will do it all the time. You will not change. Baruch Hashem. As long as you did not receive the Torah, you use the money for the Avodah Zarah. But since that you started, you realize what you did, the Avodah that you did, you started to study Torah, so you did it with the God, you built the Mishkan. So carry on building the Mishkan. And what it is Mishkan? It's myself. It's Shman is a Mishkan. So I have to carry on building myself all the time. Maybe this is the truth. People who have a lot of money, they will count the money, they will count. And after that they count, they will count again. It's the same amount. They will count again, it's the same amount. But the Torah, no. The more you study Torah, you repeat it, you will understand it every time, a different way. It gives you a pleasure. And that's what Moshe Rabbeinu Alav Shalom, before he passed away, he started to teach them. And I want just to tell you this. Before Moshe Rabbeinu, maybe this is a big hiddush that I have. And I finish with this hiddush. This is the biggest hiddush that I have. Moshe Rabbeinu, he started to explain them the Torah after he told them, after the war that of Sihon and Og. Now that, because Sihon and Og, they were in the border with Israel. Mm-hmm. Now they won the war, and all that land they give it to Gad, to Reuven. Now it's the open door. Now they can go through Eretz Israel. Now the world is that. But why did not mention them? The war that he did against Midian. It was not a mention, because Hashem told him, once you do the war against Midian, you kill Bilam, you will die. So why Moshe Rabbeinu did not mention this? It only said, Ahari, I go to it, Sihon Melech Emori. Moshe Rabbeinu started to explain the Torah to the Jews, or what I'm telling you, after the war of Sihon and Og, now it's they're the border to enter Eretz Israel. Why? Moshe Rabbeinu don't mention the death of the war that he did against Midian. Because if he would not do the war against Midian, Moshe would not die. Because Hashem said to Moshe, when you do the war against Midian, you will die. Don't forget, Midian, they were the people who pushed the Jews to do the Avera with the woman. Mm-hmm. According to the advice that Bilam gave to Balak. So why Moshe Rabbeinu not mention after the war that they did with Midian, with Sihon, and Og, and Midian? That I don't mention Midian. But I mentioned that Moshe Rabbeinu spoke to them, Be'eder Yarden, Be'eris Mo'avu. That it was after the war of Midian. Why did not mention the war of Midian? Look, you have three companies. You don't mention to me only two companies. You mention the three companies. You have three big companies. And for me, the war of Midian, it was the top. Because if you will not do the war of Midian, he will still remain alive. So why you don't mention it? You know why? Moshe Rabbeinu Alav HaShalom, he knew that the Jews, they were very sad that he's gonna die. They were sad why he did the war against Midian. They were not happy. They knew that once Moshe Rabbeinu would do the war against Midian, he will die. So Moshe Rabbeinu didn't want to mention Midian. Because if he will mention Midian,
yeah,
the Jews will be sad.
Yeah.
And Moshe Rabbeinu, he didn't want, and then the Jews will not think about what he wanted to tell them. They will only think about his death. Yes, yeah, so why did the war against Midian? If you will not do the war against Midian, you will remain alive. So Moshe Rabbeinu did not mention the war against Midian. Fabulous. But I have another answer more beautiful than that. Midian is not death yet. According to the Zohar Kadosh, and I saw this as well in the book of Rav Nachman of Breslev, his Likutei Halachot, he said there from the Zohar, from Kabbalah, that even that Midian, even that Bilam died, the clip of the Tumah that he created, it's remained.
Till today.
That was Moshe Rabbeinu, he was buried in front, opposite of Beit Peor. In front of the Avodah Zarah of Peor. To reduce the klipa, the Tumah of Midian.
When Mashiach comes.
That way, when Mashiach will come, Moshe Rabbeinu, he will live, he will come out from his tomb, and he switch off the klipa once for all. That way he did not mention the war against Midian, because the war is not finished yet. Like Amalek. Amalek is not finished yet. The war against Amalek remained. So Moshe Rabbeinu said to Israel, don't think that we won Midian, we won the clip of Midian, it still remains. Only through Torah you can beat her up. There is two kinds of winning a war. A physical war, the more weapon you have, you win the war. But a spiritual war, there is no end. It's you cannot beat him once for all. You beat him now, he come back 1 minute after. So there is no end. That's why Moshe Rabbeinu, he did not mention the war of Midian, because this was not finished yet. It's up to you. It's up to you. Maybe tomorrow you will go to France, to Canada, to America. Wherever you go, there is Midian there. Wherever you go, there is Midian. That's why Moshe Rabbeinu warned them, the war against Midian is not finished yet. The attention, like the bad advice, a Jew, there is two ways how it can kill him, or physically or spiritually. Or physical or spiritual. This is one way. Assimilation is finished. So that's why Moshe Rabbeinu Alav HaShalom, before he passed away, like the Gemara said, he explained the Torah to the Jews at 70 ways. I mean, 70 languages in English, in Spanish, in Arabic. 70 languages. The question is, why 70 languages? The Jews that they were in the desert, they speak only Hebrew. Yes or no? So why in English, why in Spanish, why in Arabic, why in the... You know why Moshe Rabbeinu want to mention to them? It will be one day that the Beit HaMikdash will be destroyed and you will not live in Eretz Israel. You have to go all away. You will have to go to exile. So don't think because you are in exile, you cannot do Torah Mitzvot. Wherever you are, you have to do Torah Mitzvot.
But so at the end of this, the Torah and the Mitzvot is the medicine for everything.
Yes, it's a Torah, it's a medicine. Now you understand why Hashem, why Moshe Rabbeinu, Alav HaShalom, now Hashem, you understand. And just to finish, Eikev, last 2 weeks, And if you will start to learn the parasha of Eikev. Eikev, that means how much you have to be careful even with the small mitzvot. Usually people, they are after the big mitzvot. What about the small one? Usually people, they don't care about the small mitzvot. But sometimes you have to care more about the small mitzvot. Something happened to me. Something happened to me. That one day, just imagine, you want to go to do your shopping. If you have $1 missing, she will not accept. You cannot, if you have the cash, you want to pay for all what you bought, but if you have $1 missing, you cannot. I mean, it's nothing $1. She will tell you, $1 is something, it's money. It's worth. You know, if you want to buy a ticket, if you tell her, I have $2 missing, even if the ticket costs a lot of money, no. She needs the account. We have to give her the exact money. So that's what Moshe Rabbeinu Al Tashono. He wants the Bnei Yisrael, Eli Adivarim. What Moshe Rabbeinu wants the Jews, and he teaches the Jews, be careful. You with the Torah, there is no change. Don't only think, I will do the big mitzvot, the small mitzvot. All the time I do them. So if once I didn't do it perfectly, it's nothing. No. Because we warn you. Be careful. Be more particular, you know. Be careful with the small mitzvot than the big mitzvot. Because the big mitzvot, you know, they are big, like not looking a woman, like not smoke on Shabbat. It's like I have to fast on Yom Kippur. You play goal, you play, you know, football, you run and the kippah fail. You carry on, it's nothing, after we put it there. Okay. So this show, I say this show for the memory of one woman that she passed away yesterday. The sister-in-law of my daughter-in-law. She passed away yesterday at the age of 44-year-old. Hilushmata. And Eishmat, the boy that he passed away again yesterday, 14-year-old. Paris. It was the late son of Rabbi Shalom Abesser. Yesterday. He said it was for me a black day, I didn't show it to nobody. And yesterday. So here at son that Hashem may look the way young people. So, Be'ezrat Hashem may their soul be in Gan Eden and in Gazon. May Hashem give you bracha v'etzlacha and b'ruach Hashem.
Nazir.